roster of the top ranked, the Huskies have turned it up a notch in the tournament. They have an average margin of victory of over 36 points per game and have been challenged but once. In Philly, defense will be key. And all tournament long, the Huskies have been their opponent's defensive nightmare, forcing 25 turnovers and collecting 15 steals per game. Connecticut can turn up the pressure and take over the tempo. They are led by Kodak All-America Shea Ralph and Stefano Brosimova. Offensive efficiency abounds in this deep lineup. Seven players scoring eight or more points per game, and a team field goal percentage near 60 make this as explosive an offense as there is here in Philadelphia. State's win over Louisiana Tech in the regional finals was just the next step for the Lady Lions. The final steps will rely on an offense that has the ability to step out and drain the three-pointer at an average of better than 40%. The inside game is tough. Penn State pounds the offensive glass for second and third opportunities while also controlling the defensive glass. In four tournament games, Penn State has out-rebounded their opponents by more than 11 boards per game. On defense, the marks grade just as high. A championship caliber number in field goal percentage defense contributes to the Lady Lions' belief that the next steps they will take will lead them to their primary goal of the season, their first national championship. And I'm not sure if we checked with VH1 if we could do that pop-up video thing, but we all want to be happy.
I'm afraid to think what they're putting up when we're talking.
I know, exactly. Right. A little bubble. But okay, we're 3 minutes away from the tip-off. What do you see in this game, Vera?
Absolutely. I think for Penn State, it's got to be Helen Darling. She's got to be the one to look to be an offensive threat. What that does is it allows the inside to open up, and that, of course, is their strength. We already talked about Amazon.com. Yeah. The other thing is rebounding. Helen Darling has had 11, 9, 10 rebounds per game during the tournament in very, very critical moments. She has to make sure she stays on the boards as well. She's got a tough assignment ahead of her.
I think it's going to come down to handling pressure. You know that UConn's going to come after you. Helen Darling has got to handle the full court pressure, the run and jump. It's going to be very important that she have receivers to throw the ball to. Everybody else can't just run down the court. They've got to come back to the ball.
Again, it's a rematch, much anticipated. The first Final Four for the Lady Lions of Penn State, the fourth Final Four in school history for Connecticut. They're going to move on for the right to meet Tennessee. Annie and Mike with the call again.
Robin, thanks very much. And Connecticut has that wonderful 34-1 record this year because they have a collection of stars that play as a team. But every once in a while, one of those stars shines through, like Svetlana Abrosimova, who was the MVP of the regional.
You could really pick about five or six players on this team, but Svetlana Abrosimova had a wonderful game against LSU in the East Regional. She was hitting shots from the outside, taking control of the board, knocking away loose balls, hitting on the inside. She's the type of player that scores in flurries and does things in flurries, and she's going to have to do that again against Penn State. She's a two-time All-American, and she's fun to watch.
For underdog Penn State, the pressure is going to fall on another regional MVP, and that's Helen Darling.
Also, Big Ten Player of the Year. She didn't get Player of the Week. She got Player of the Year. And this kid can do a lot of things as far as handling the ball. She was second in the nation in assists, but she can also score from the outside and penetrate. And I think that's really going to be important as far as her game, as far as controlling her offense, not only distributing the ball, but putting some points on for her teammates.
Gino Auriemma and Rini Portland both learned about basketball Philadelphia style as kids, and the influence continued during their playing days and into their early coaching careers.
One of the unique things about Philadelphia is they're experts on everything. Everybody knows everything about everything down here.
Friendly. Philadelphia friendly.
The coaches here think they invented the game.
I chuckle when I say I'm from Philadelphia.
And the people watching the game definitely think they know more than the coaches.
Overwhelming at times.
What is it about Philly? It's competition and it's busting each other's chops.
Final matchup between the Penn State Lady Lions and the Connecticut Huskies. Let's take a look at the first plus starting lineups. How about the backcourt, Ann?
Helen Darling, a strong rebounder out of the backcourt, and Sue Bird just controls everything. Just a steady force for the Connecticut backcourt.
How about up front?
In the front court for the Lady Lions, Andrea Gardner, very quick inside, very active. Swin Cash, also a quick player. She's going to have to play big for Connecticut.
We've already told you the Philly connection is very strong in this tournament. For more on that, let's check in with Michelle Tafoya.
All right, Mike. Well, unlike the other coaches here, Penn State's Renee Portland is making her Final Four debut, and how fitting it is that it's here in Philadelphia, back where it all began for the Pennsylvania native. In 1972, she was a freshman at Immaculata College, playing for Kathy Rush and leading the Mighty Max to three straight national championships. She earned three Outstanding College Athlete of America awards and a New York Press All-America citation during her college career. Then she became an assistant at her alma mater before taking charge at St. Joseph's College here in Philly for 2 years. Now here she is, 24 years removed from Immaculata, but back in the city where it all began. And Mike, today is her birthday. Penn State is 3-0 this season on team members' birthdays. How about that?
Well, if you believe in omens, that's a pretty good one. Her chance to shine in the Final Four. Gino Auriemma brings the nation's number one team into the Final Four, the fourth time that he has gotten the Huskies this far. His 95 team won undefeated and took the national championship.
And this Penn State team might think they have a little good luck charm, too. Michael Peck, one of the assistants, the brother of Carolyn Peck, the National Coach of the Year and winner last year at Purdue, national champion.
We are set to go for the right to go to a national championship game to meet the Tennessee Lady Vols. Connecticut controls 2-on-1 off the tip. Abrosimova missed the shot. The follow. Schumacher can't hit it. And the rebound to Marin Walsa.
Well, just like you said, Omen.
Backdoor cut. Shepard can't hit. Schumacher with a rebound. Both teams wanting to press. Jay Ralph to Abrosimova.
You have to say a little bit of nerves coming out also.
Swing cash. Good pump fake. Missed the shot. And the rebound goes to Andrea Garner, who's averaging nearly 9 a game.
Dino Auriemma said in practice yesterday, he said, hey, just have fun, loosen up. But you know what? These are kids. And he said in the beginning of the game, and even being out there, those nerves are going to be a little rattled. And both teams look like it right now.
Abrosimova ahead of the pack, and Connecticut takes a 2-0 lead. They love to run. They love to press. Darling, the Big Ten Player of the Year, goes right down the lane. Shea Ralph knocks it away from him.
Once Darling breaks the press off that dribble, she has to be aware now that she's beaten the defense, but they're behind her. And she's got to get the rid of the basketball to somebody in front of her so somebody doesn't knock it away.
For the year, she's averaging less than 11 points a game, but in the tournament, 14 and a half. She has really stepped up her game in precious situations. This one is off the knee of Walsh, and the junior from Bloomington, Minnesota, turns it over.
And Marin Walsh and Lucy Shepard have also been playing well in the tournament for Penn State. I think the nerves are a little touchy right now for Penn State. Remember, this is their very first time, and they're playing in front of a home crowd. They think it is. They're the only team from Pennsylvania playing.
Schumacher comes out high to help. Abrosimova can't get the bounce. Shea Ralph with a rebound. Had it stripped on the way up. Lisa Shepard hustling down court to the Lady Lions. Nothing there. Backs it out. Double dribble.
The two things that Renee Portland said before the game. Transition defense, because they felt the first time that they played Connecticut earlier in the season that Connecticut just ran them to death off missed shots. The other thing was rebounding. They've got to concentrate on rebounds. Three of their last six games, they've had 51 rebounds, so they're a team that can't rebound.
Connecticut, a terrific rebounding team, as we've seen already in this tournament in the East. The size and athleticism. Jay Ralph working her way around the defense, gets it inside to Schumacher for the easy two. Every made basket sets up the press. Falcone ahead of the defense, hits it. That's a three. Chrissy Falcone hitting better than 37% from beyond the rim. Quinn Cash going with the ball inside. They couldn't get it to her. Now Abrosimova does.
Penn State play in that 2-3 zone of Connecticut trying to pass over.
Walseth ahead of the crowd, couldn't handle a pass, tipped off her out of bounds, and Penn State just turning it over too many times. That's three already, and we haven't played 3 minutes yet. UConn with a 12-rebound margin in ball games. Penn State against UConn in that first one, won by UConn 87-74.
Looking on paper, too, this Connecticut team, Gino Auriemma has said all year long that players have accepted their roles. They're a more mature team this year and probably don't start their best five starters. He's got an unbelievable bench.
Even though they don't have a senior out there. 5 second call. And Penn State returns the favor on the turnover.
Well, it's plays like that that Gino Auriemma gets upset at his team. He feels that you've got to execute, you've got to get the ball inside. Sue Bird still kind of shaking that right hand.
Darling brings it up against Bird. Yeah, I think she heard it.
This one of those stingers.
Garner, a little fadeaway with the left hand, didn't get the roll, and a broken over comes out. Head always up. Sue Bird, a great outside shooter, misses this one, a broken over, offensive rebound. She was the MVP of the East Regional, and she's off to a hot start here in the Final Four.
One of the things that Penn State is going to have to do, especially on the defensive end, is lock out somebody like a broken over.
And they'll trap you whenever they can. Shepherd hits the three. You've got to make the trapping team pay, and that time they did. We're tied at six. Bird, good head fake to get to the baseline. Missed the shot.
Here you saw Lisa Shepherd really trying to do a good job blocking out, and she created the foul.
Timeout on the court, 15:58 to go, first half.
The NCAA Women's Championship game, Sunday at 9 on ESPN.
There's a place in America where the sun shines a little brighter.
The Lady Lions.
Well, here's the double team by Connecticut on Darling. We talked about her poise. Brosimova's got to make a decision who she's going to take. And Darling steps through and gets the pass over to Shepherd in the corner for a three-point shot. But she stays poised, steps right through. See how high Brosimova goes? Well, it leaves Shepherd wide open and knocks it down for the three. She was 4 of 6 against Louisiana Tech for 25 points.
Penn State with the ball and the chance to take the lead. Darling outside, gets it to Falcone. Back to Darling, shot clock is 10 inside to Garner. She missed and Brosimova with another rebound.
That high post area is open. One of the things that Penn State beat Connecticut on in the Connecticut-Penn State game earlier was that they got the ball inside the high-low post, and Connecticut really worked defensively, and there they come up with the steal.
And a sloppy at both ends. Shea Ralph trying to get into the lane, forced the shot, can't hit it, and the follow by Asia Jones, who just checked in. She gets her first bucket.
Well, the Connecticut team doesn't lose much when they go to the bench. Jones, a good rebounder inside.
Good ball movement to get Falcone open. Instead, she goes inside to Shepherd for the layup. Excellent passing.
And good movement, creating the space by Penn State. They're a team, as you said, maybe not as great an athlete per se, but so they've got to keep moving, get themselves in the open spot.
Brosimova gets the entry pass inside, and Williams with a miss. Loose ball of Brosimova. They're going to call her for travel. This is the largest crowd to see a college basketball game in the state of Pennsylvania tonight. Over 20,000 on hand.
Here you see Shea Ralph on the defensive end, just not even seeing where Shepherd is. Shepherd snuck right behind her. You've got to see ball and man. You know, in that first meeting, too, Connecticut had 24 turnovers against this Penn State team.
One of the few teams around that's good enough to overcome those kind of mistakes.
That was a tough pass.
Loose ball of Brosimova comes up with another one, and she is fouled.
Well, Helen Darling is one player that cannot afford to get in foul trouble. She had four fouls against Connecticut, played all 40 minutes, but she needs to stay in this game, can't make silly fouls like that. And Renee Portland and the coaches are saying, hey, you got to be smart, pointing to their heads. Don't pick those kind of things up.
She won the Frances Pomeroy Naismith Award as the best player in the nation, 5'8 or under. She's listed at 5'7. Might be a little generous there.
Aren't coaches always generous on those heights?
Until they get close to 7 feet, then they cut it down. Asia Jones missed it, got it back, and scores. Asia Jones has four off the bench. UConn up by two. Darling left all alone, so she takes the shot. Asia Jones with a rebound. Here's a Brosimova ahead. Williams, what great body control to make the catch and get the shot up and in. Williams with a reach-in steal.
You know, R.M. said before the game, he told me that he felt Tamika Williams would be a key in this game.
You just knew Sue Bird would hit that shot. She has made so many huge shots this year and delivering the killer blow.
Shooting almost 50% from three-point range.
Shepard tried to go baseline, was cut off, and wheels into the lane. Down low, got it to Rashana Barnes, got the ball back. Barnes puts it up and in. Rashana Barnes out of Philadelphia averages 7 points a game off the bench. Williams down the lane, lost it. Sue Bird, two in a row from downtown.
You, Sue Bird, was 4 of 7 from three-point range. She just put that dagger in there.
Well, for this year, she is 69 for 137, so she has gone over 50% for the season. That let her take all of them. Darling, your shot clock is down to 5. Tough position to put Garner in. And the shot clock violation.
Tamika Williams made that happen on the defensive end. Bird just kind of trailing back, setting herself up behind the three-point line. Great rotation. The good shooters always get those seams going.
She's got a nice stroke. Katrina Carr, number 12, in for the first time for the Lady Lions. And this is a 10-2 UConn run. Bird had that shot blocked by Barnes. Good defense. She reached in and got a piece of it. We've got a timeout on the court, 11:55 to go, first half.
To better nurture the rose, we had to get inside the mind of the rose.
I'm hot. I'm hungry. I'm just gonna wilt. Oh, something's biting my knees.
Introducing Bayer Advanced Garden 2-in-1 Rose and Flower Care. It works up through the roots, and it both feeds your roses and protects them from bugs in one easy step.
Never go hungry again or get nibbled.
Bear Advanced. Better thinking, better results.
Dieter here knows about cars.
I'm an expert.
Yeah.
If you're just joining us for the women's Final Four from Philadelphia, Tennessee has already advanced. The Lady Vols eliminated the Scarlet Knights of Rutgers in the first national semifinal. Connecticut and Penn State playing for the right to face Tennessee for the championship on Sunday night. Our game summary so far, UConn shooting 40%. And look at the work on the offensive board. 7 offensive rebounds, which has given them a crack at 9 second chance points. That's why they're up by 8.
And already 6 turnovers in the first half of Penn State.
Darling guarded by Sue Bird. That's a high screen.
Connecticut switching up their defenses.
Johnson with the switch. Tanika in for the first time. Katrina Carr gets her first bucket. She's averaged 5.6 points a game as a reserve this year. And gives them some speed on the outside. Williams with a runner.
Kinetic is really controlling the tempo of the game. One, as you said, with the rebounding, they're getting things running. But defensively, they're really slowing things up for Penn State. Penn State having a tough time getting in the lane.
Barnes makes a very athletic move, gets in the lane, but missed the shot. Here comes Bird back the other way. Daisy Jones couldn't get the shot and kicked it back out. Samova will try a three off the mark, and the rebound to Darling. She averages almost 6 rebounds a game.
You always forget to block those little ones out, huh?
You'll get in there even if you do. Shepherd, nice entry pass for the easy layup, and Walsh has the bucket courtesy of the nice dish.
And you have,
first
to,
two.
You have to like that little pump fake.
Asia Jones in the lane with the miss. The rebound goes to Barnes.
The big thing for Penn State on the defensive end, Connecticut has done a pretty good job getting the ball inside of their post. So they've got Penn State has to push them out a little bit more, get them where they receive the ball, not on the block.
Carr goes baseline. She's cut off. Walsh with 10 on the shot clock. Down Darling. And taken away. Excellent defense by Bird to throw some over with a loose ball. And she just blew by Walsh.
Well, there's a difference that we saw in the first game with Tasha Pointer was able to commit herself to taking the shot. Helen Darling has a tendency to get inside and then kick the ball out. And as a defensive player, if you know that tendency, you'll drop off.
Penn State has already committed 7 turnovers, and Katrina Carr, only a 25% long-range shooter, buries a 3 to cut it back to 5.
Not a big-time score. She only averages a little over 5 points a game.
Williams trying to get into the lane. Off to Asia Jones. Back out to Bird. She's hit 3 from outside. Sue Bird, who they don't look to score very often, only averages 10.9, has hit 3 threes in the first half.
Well, defensively, that's where you've got to key in on. You know Sue Bird's going to knock some shots out. You're going to have to sacrifice somewhere else and force them to take the shot. They're going to call the travel there. But Penn State's going to have to do a better job on Sue Bird.
Walseth tried to muscle her way inside and walked in the process.
The defense is so concerned about clogging up the middle, but by the time they get out, here you see the space and they're trying to cover it, but by the time they get out to Sue Bird, she's got all the time in the world. You can clog in as much as you want to.
You better get to a 50% three-point shooter. Across the mold, a nice head fake and then a great bounce pass to the baseline. But they can't finish it as Swin Cash is back in Mississippi.
But that's not the kind of shot that Swin Cash usually takes. So those are the kind of shots that Penn State has to sacrifice.
Helen Darling looking over to Renee Portland. Under 8 minutes to go in the first half, and UConn leads by 8. Carr can't get inside. Deep entry pass to Garner. She's double teamed, goes through a trap. Missed the shot. Shea Ralph and Darling both go tumbling. And they'll call Shea Ralph for the foul. Timeout on the court, 7:42 to go in the half. UConn by 8.
Westside Louisiana Tech in the regionals. And for the senior Helen Darling, it was a particularly emotional moment to get this far.
I was exhausted with that 1 minute left, and I was just looking like, I can make it 1 minute. And it didn't hit me until I was walking off, and the look on her face, she was just so excited, and she held her arms out just waiting for me, and I just really broke down. It was a special moment for me.
There is a bond quite unlike any other between player and coach, even if they don't always get along. There is still that bond that exists, and success makes it even deeper. Katrina Carr hits another big basket. She's been a savior for Penn State in this first half.
You know, there's been so much talk about the three coaches from the Pennsylvania area, and there's so much magic with the game being here in Philadelphia. You go back to 1975 when Renee Portland was a senior, and they played in the championship, Immaculata against Delta State, going for the fourth national championship. It was at Penn State.
Excellent hustle. Garner got down court. They hit her with a perfect strike. It is 25-21. Penn State all of a sudden back within four. Jay Ralph left alone. Missed the shot. Offensive rebound to Swin Cash.
Helen Darling, second in the nation in assists, but Garner, which they're the 1-2 punch, the seniors on this team, know each other so well. Garner dropping it down for the two.
Darling back the other way, 7:44 and counting, first half. I think it's 6:44 and counting, 4-point lead. Garner, too strong, but out of bounds off Connecticut. Check in with Michelle Tafoya. Michelle.
Well, Mike, throughout the tournament, Helen Darling has been wearing a flak jacket under her uniform to protect her ribs. She took an elbow to the ribs during Penn State's final regular season game, and following that, found herself a bit tentative driving the lane. Now, the flak jacket has restored her confidence, and she's been playing without fear throughout this tournament.
All right, thanks, Michelle. We volunteered you to try the baseball bat test this morning. I guess you couldn't find another flak jacket.
There was no way I was letting you swing at it.
I'd have missed you. Don't worry. That shot forced by Darling. Offensive rebound. The block as Carr tried to follow it. Another loose ball. And Shea Ralph's going to come up with it. Quickly to Bird. To 3-on-2. Abrosimova. Missed the layup. Got it back. And she's fouled. Walseth commits the personal.
Shea is pretty physical out there, especially when you got somebody like Shea Ralph. She's like a train coming at you. Sometimes you back off. A nice pass by Sue Bird. And Abrosimova misses the layup right here. She gets a second chance as far as going to the free throw line. And a little frustration because whether the team is missing because they're nervous or they're just missing shots.
We saw it with her in the regional. She missed some layups in the Elite Eight game. She's the first free throw. She will get another. Abrosimova already with 7 points and 6 boards in this game, and we've played less than 14 minutes. Came over from St. Petersburg, Russia. Her parents are still there.
So Gino Auriemma talked about pressure. See, he felt that his team didn't have pressure. You know, they lost the game to Tennessee, took a lot of the pressure off in the sense of, hey, I'm not talking about an undefeated season coming into this Final Four, but if you're prepared, you shouldn't have pressure on you.
Darling did a great job at dribbling through the double team. Then she couldn't hit the shot, and it was knocked out off Connecticut. Into Barnes, and Rashana Barnes, the sophomore, hits the jumper. She has 4. And the lead is back to 4.
Barnes has been a nice lift off the bench for the Lady Lions.
Really, her reserves have shown more spark offensively than the starters have. Bird to Schumacher. After hitting the 3 threes, now they have to come out to respect Sue Bird's shot, and it opens up the middle, and Penn State throws it away again.
And that's the one thing about this Connecticut team. You know they're going to press, you know you're going to turn the ball over, but don't get frustrated. And that's what LSU talked about in the East Regional Final against Connecticut. They turn the ball over, but you've got to have a ball handler that can go through that press, and then also you've got to be able to capitalize and score off it after you break the press.
10 turnovers so far for the Lady Lions. Abrosimova looking for Asia Jones.
Look at
now
how
they
deep
get the entry to, and she missed.
She missed, but look at how deep she got the ball.
Shepherd, Abrosimova nearly a steal on Darling. Abrosimova with a big height advantage here. Let's see if Darling is quicker and can take her off the dribble. Shot clock down 9. They get it inside Garner. He kicks it back outside, and there's the air ball. Got a good look from Darling, but she couldn't hit the shot.
Well, it wasn't a great play in the sense of where Gardner got the ball. She got it 8 feet away from the basket.
Shea Rao tried the scoop shot in traffic, knocked out of bounds off of Penn State.
Gardner at 6'3 has got to do a better job trying to post up.
Tough inbounds pass, saved by Bird. Left alone for three, and she never got set on that one and missed it after hitting three straight.
The look.
Yeah. Coaches learn that early, don't they? Darling backs out against the double team. She needs somebody to come to her, and nobody does. And she's forced to call a timeout. 4:11 to go, first half. UConn by 6 over Penn State.
Discipline creates performance. As of the most recent calendar year end, the AIM Constellation Fund outperformed the S&P 500 for a 20-year period, something only a handful of mutual funds can claim. The idea is discipline. The purpose is performance. The name is AIM.
So what you're saying is you can't change your oil every 3,000 miles because you're too busy. So you push it. Just like your cheap brother-in-law at one of those all-you-can-eats. Hey, it's your car.
Connecticut by 6. Now we'll check in with Michelle Safoya. Audio problem, can't get to Michelle right now. We'll get back to her as soon as we can. The defense hasn't been able to get to Sue Bird. She's hit 3 out of 4 three-pointers to lead Connecticut in scoring in this first half. They're up by 6, 29-23.
And Connecticut's getting a lot of shots at the basket.
Darling gets it to Carr.
Connecticut's kind of in a matchup switching, and they look like a Brosa Mova's running the baseline.
Tough shot for Carr. Offensive rebound, now a loose ball, and here comes Shea Ralph back to Bird. A Brosa Mova down the lane, bodies fly, no whistle.
Now see if Gardner stands the ground, that's a charge, but it's almost like he's backing off of Brosa Mova.
Asia Jones. Good offensive movement by UConn the last couple of sets. Brosa Mova trying to drive and away from the ball. This may be an illegal screen. And it will go against UConn. The lead is 6, but Gino Auriemma not happy with his club's execution right now.
Whoa, cool.
Cool sight?
Cool sight?
What's this cool?
What's this cool?
Cool what?
Cool sight?
What's it cool?
Boatsmith.com.
Boatsmith.com?
Boatsmith.com.
Insurance.
Cool insurance?
Over 300 companies.
I'm hot for this.
Instant is good.
And the best quote is...
Graphics are totally lame. Yeah, but the quotes will blow you away.
Boatsmith.com. Have you ever said
cool
to insurance?
I have the goosebumps.
There's always a combination of taking a knowledge and applying it. For example, I know who the shooter is. I know what he does, what he thinks, under stress, how he'll act, what's his favorite thing to do, what's his least favorite thing to do. And I got most of my rebounds before he took the shot.
Knowledge is the edge.
Bag, I am sitting alongside Carolyn Peck, who last year brought Purdue to the national championship. What kind of memories does being here in Philly bring back for you?
Well, it's just an awesome feeling. I was watching Michael before the game, and he was looking around at how many people were here, and to have so many people here for a women's basketball game is incredible.
Your brother, Michael, on the bench for Penn State, an assistant coach, and, of course, Penn State in its first Final Four. What kind of advice did you give him?
I tell him you got to have fun, you got to enjoy it, and you got to treat it like just any other game. Because if you get tense, your players get tense. It's a great accomplishment to get this far. Enjoy it.
We enjoyed watching you. Thanks a lot, Carolyn. Back to you, Mike.
Well, Michelle, you're absolutely right. Carolyn Peck with a great run last year. There's a three from Shepherd at Old Fall. Brosa Mova.
And that's what Renee Portland talked to her team about, as far as having fun, enjoying this time. It's special, yes, every minute of it. But you know what? All you juniors and sophomores and freshmen that are coming back next year, grab those freshmen and say, this is what it's going to be like. We can do it again.
Darling to bring it up against the trap. Garner helping out. Wide open Carr. She hit three early shots. Sue Bird on the run. Great hesitation, and she's fouled on the way up.
You just love the way Connecticut gets the ball off a defensive rebound and off to the races. It's like everybody's clearing out. And defensively, again, Renee Portland talked about the transition defense for her team to get back. She said that maybe they got to send somebody back. But look at Sue Bird with the hesitation and then blowing by the defense. And they call the foul from behind. You see Darling grab the arm.
This is the best free throw shooter on the court. Sue Bird shoots almost 90%. We already told you she shoots better than 50% now from the free throw line. She's hit three threes today and has 10 points. Make it 11, and the lead has grown to 8. And again, every time they score, they can set up that full court trapping defense. Darling. Shot clock's already half gone. Barnes, nice entry pass and the little running hook by Garner.
Good patience by Penn State to execute, wait for their screens, and Garner cut off and was wide open. Nice pass inside.
31-25. Throws him over to Bird.
And it helps when you can't have that many players handling the ball, bringing it up.
Rosamova kicks it back outside. The jumper by Johnson is good. So many weapons. Her first two.
In the last game against LSU, she only had 1 point because she played such great defense that she's a player that can put points on the scoreboard for you.
1:39 to go first half. The lead is up to 8. Helen Darling, nice job to get herself open. Abrosimova, that may be on her over the back, and it is. Coming up at halftime, Robin, Vera, and Jay will be along, and along with one thing that they'll be doing is talking about the Tennessee-Rutgers recap, and Pat Summitt will be here with us live, the victorious coach in game number one. And she'll be preparing for yet another national championship final. Christy Falcone with a three. Schumacher with a rebound. Daisy Jones, she loves to get the ball down low, and she'll force the foul call.
It's almost, in my opinion, right now that Penn State, they're playing with four players. Andrea Gardner's got to get in the game. I think she's playing real lax. They had an opportunity to double team right there. And she's just got to be a lot more physical. She's kind of laying back.
And we're talking about the team's fifth all-time scorer, third all-time rebounder. So she has played very well over a long course of history.
Well, she's had a really good year. She has. And she's a Philadelphia native. She's from right here, J.R. Masterman High School. And it's important for her, man. She's coming home and wants to play well.
Asia Jones out of Piscataway, New Jersey, hits the second free throw. The lead is back to 10. She has 6 on the night. This one's knocked away, but recovered by Darling. Darling gets it inside. Garner missed the shot, and Schumacher with a rebound. Nearly tipped away from her. Bird ahead to Jones. Sue Bird sees the court so well.
Well, Connecticut did such a good job defensively. As soon as Garner caught the ball, they put a body on her. And when she gets contact, she kind of doesn't know what to do. She went up for the shot, and then again, the defensive rebound. And as soon as that rebound goes, I think what happens, Penn State, if they're not going to get any deeper, any offensive rebounds in second and third opportunities, they might as well just turn around and run back.
Sue Bird thought she, or Shea Ralph thought she had a steal. Instead, she's going to be called for a foul.
Look at how Jones just really ran the floor and got down. And then here's the play again. You see it. Garner was the one that had to come from all the way back from the other baseline to try and defend it.
Biggest lead for the Huskies, up by a dozen, and under 40 seconds to go in the half. Big possession here for Penn State. They'd like to cut it down to single digits if they could get a three-point play somehow. And Darling certainly capable of doing that for them. Three-pointer from Garner. Huge shot.
Maybe that's where she should be shooting the ball from.
Maybe. UConn will have a last chance. Bird down the lane with a runner. Came up short. Falcone, good if it goes. Off the mark from midcourt. A huge offensive first half for Sue Bird, who had 11 points, including three huge three-point shots at the half. Number one UConn leading at 37-28 over the Lady Lions of Penn State.
This halftime report is presented by Monistat, the number one doctor-recommended brand for the treatment of yeast infections.
Mike and Annie, thank you very much. A nine-point deficit for the Lady Lions at the half. They were down by 15 the first time they played, and it was a three-point game a couple times in the second half when they played. So what do you think?
Well, Penn State's got to do a better job of handling UConn's pressure. They turned the ball over a little bit too much, and they weren't really helping out ball handlers by coming back to the basketball. Early on in the game, Penn State did a pretty good job of handling the pressure, but you can see Helen Darling gets caught in a trap. Andrea Garner does a nice job of coming to the ball instead of just standing there. That gave the passer someone to throw the ball to. Then Christy Falcone comes to the ball. She does a nice job of presenting herself as a receiver to Andrea Garner. As a result, you're going to see Lisa Shepherd wide open for a standstill three-point shot. Great pass by Christy Falcone. A nice job of hitting that standstill jumper. UConn's got to make them put the ball on the floor. But a better job needs to be done by Penn State of handling that pressure. They also have to get back in transition because UConn scoring way too many easy buckets, looking down court and passing ahead.
Now that's exactly what I want to shirt tail on. They definitely have to do a better job in getting back in transition. And also, we talked about Helen Darling, not to put this whole game on her shoulders, but right now her stat, 0.3 turnovers. She does, however, have three rebounds, which has been her forte. If they're going to send Helen Darling in for a rebound, that means maybe Christy Falcone, they're going to have a sacrifice and cheat to get somebody back to handle Sue Bird in transition, because Sue Bird is... Well, she's flying.
She is. Has 11 first-half points, putting 3 of 5 from three-point range. All right, we're at the half. A 9-point lead for the Connecticut Huskies. They know that the winner of this game will move on to face Tennessee in the championship game on Sunday. We'll talk to Pat Summitt when we come back here to the First Union Center in Philadelphia.
Hey, we made it.
Is this place heaven or what?
You want heaven? Try this.
New Wild Vines Raspberry Zinfandel.
Friday, yes.
It's not just Zinfandel, it's Raspberry Zinfandel.
Great. Oh. Sorry. Oh.
Wild Vines new Raspberry Zinfandel. It goes perfect with letting go, leaving the world behind. New Wild Vines Raspberry Zinfandel. It's wine like you've never tasted.
A computer that is so last century. Introducing IPAC, the first internet device for business. A kinder, simpler device with the Intel Pentium 3 processor that taps into the power of the internet and meets all your business computing needs. The age of simple internet computing has arrived. IPAC from Compaq.
Rutgers in Tennessee at the end of the half. Tasha Pointer made it just a two-point game.
But then in the second half, Tennessee comes alive. The turnaround by Tamika Catchings. She got 13 points and 12 rebounds. Then Kara Lawson, a super second half for this freshman as well. The driving layup, she had 19. And Tennessee is on to the championship game on Sunday. Michelle Snow, 7 blocks. That is a final four record. Pat Summitt now 9-3 in national semifinal games. And as we take a look at the numbers, everything pretty much the same. And you get to free throws. And once again, Tennessee going to the line a lot more than their opponent. And Kara Lawson, a perfect 8-for-8 from the line in the second half. And Pat Summitt is joining us right now. And when we were sitting here chatting, you were like, oh, you're still having flashbacks of that defense by the Rutgers.
I tell you, Rutgers, their defense is so solid. They give you very little. You have to really work. But I thought Kara Lawson gave us an aggressive attack in the second half, got inside off penetration, and we really had better player in ball movement. We had to run our man offenses to even get inside.
Does it take you a half to get used to that defense? I was talking to Gino, and he plays, you know, Orema, and he plays them a few times during the regular season. It takes you about a half to get used to that matchup zone.
I'm glad it's a 40-minute game, because if it's a 20-minute game, we're in trouble. But it does take a while. I thought it took our team a while to recognize where they could get the basketball, reverse it, work it on the baseline, short corner, as well as at the elbows.
Pat, it looked like they got frustrated in the first half with the pace of the game, and they were quick-shotting a bit, settled for jump shots. What was the difference in the second half when they were so much more decisive and stronger with the ball?
Well, we really talked specifically about where we wanted to go with the basketball. We had much better player movement, better ball reversal, and obviously better penetration. I just think they settled down. They were in a bit of a panic. Catchings had 2 people on her every time she touched it. And I thought she was a little too tentative myself. So we moved her more within the offense. And she got open on the baseline. She got open in the middle. I thought Michelle Snow did some good things for us. Her presence opened up some other people.
You've also maintained that defense and rebounding pretty much has been the cornerstone of your philosophy and your program. How did that affect you today in the game? And looking ahead at these two teams, what do you think is going to happen, or how's that going to play out tomorrow?
Well, I just think you cannot put that much pressure on your offense in postseason. When you do and you go in, you think, if we don't shoot 45-50%, we lose. We at times can make people play ugly, and we play ugly on offense. So I think it's just a matter of not losing our composure and sticking to our game plan. And I really believe we're due a great offensive night.
It's been a while.
I can't even remember. But it happened to us in other postseasons, and then we shot the ball well in the championship game. It's getting there. That's the hard part. Now that we're there, hopefully we'll relax and play.
Okay, real quick, what do you think of the second half?
Well, I tell you right now, if UConn continues to push tempo and get on the boards like they're getting on the boards, then I think Penn State's going to have an uphill battle. It's hard to make runs on Connecticut, though, because they're the team that makes runs, and they do a good job answering runs. But it could be a great game. The first half I really enjoyed.
All right, Pat. Thank you so much.
I really appreciate it.
We will see Pat Summitt on Sunday. Penn State and UConn playing for the right now to move on into the championship game against the Lady Vols. They've already won 6 national championships, and Pat Summitt is shaking your head. Sunday, 9 p.m. Eastern, the pregame show at 8:30 Eastern on Sunday night. We're at the half where Connecticut leads Penn State 37-28.
This halftime report is presented by Monistat, the number one recommended brand for the treatment of yeast infection. When you have an ailment, different doctors might recommend different treatments. But for women suffering with yeast infections, the number one recommendation of doctors is specific. Monistat. Monistat starts working immediately to relieve the awful burning and itching, and it provides an effective cure. Sure, doctors have many brands of yeast infection medicine to choose from, but Monistat is their number one choice. Monistat, the number one doctor-recommended brand.
Discipline creates performance.
As of the most recent calendar year end, the AIM Constellation Fund outperformed the S&P 500 for a 20-year period, something only a handful of mutual funds can claim. The idea is discipline. The purpose is performance. The name is AIM.
ESPN's exclusive coverage of the Women's NCAA Final Four is brought to you by Monistat, who brings you tonight's halftime report.
You know, the city of brotherly love is known for so much, including, oh yes, cheesesteak. Maybe Pat Summit will stop by Pat Steak for a little victory dinner. And oh, do you look at that? Right across the place is Gino's place, but 20 more minutes to find out if he will be feasting as well. They have the Lady Lions in front of them right now. And, Jay, what do you see in the second half?
Well, Penn State got knocked back on their heels in the first half. I didn't think they were as aggressive as they needed to be in attacking pressure. You have got to attack pressure at the point it's applied. I think that Penn State, if they attack the pressure when it comes to them, they're going to get some great opportunities. They had good opportunities in the first half, just didn't take advantage of them.
Also, they're struggling in the paint, Jay, and that's got to definitely change. In fact, if my statistics are correct, they didn't even attempt a free throw. That means they're not really getting the looks inside that they want to. Only two offensive rebounds. We talked about how key those offensive rebounds were. Maybe I jinxed them. I'll take the blame if I have to. But the bottom line is this has to be a new half, and yes, they have to be a lot more aggressive inside.
You know, we talked about the senior leadership of the Lady Lions, but you have to remember this is their first appearance here at the Final Four, and they may have been overcome a little bit by the moment, but I don't think that will be the case in the second half. The Lady Lions only down by 9, 37-28. The Connecticut Huskies trying to get back to the championship game for the first time since they won it all in 1995. Come on back for the second half, everyone, between Connecticut and Penn State.
Practicing medicine at UT Medical Center makes me a better doctor.
It's the area's only teaching hospital, so every day I'm charged with training tomorrow's doctors.
Which means I can't use yesterday's information.
And that pushes me to stay on the forefront of the latest research and technology.
Well, Dan Myers, Michelle Tafoya is with us, along with our entire ESPN crew. Glad you could join us tonight for the Women's Final Four. Typical UConn first half. Somebody steps up and make the big shots. In this case, it was Sue Bird.
It really has. They're controlling the tempo. Sue Bird came out and knocked down three-pointers right away. She's got 11 in this first half, but she was so poised. She spotted up, but it wasn't just that. She's got three assists in this first half, finding people in the open court, getting out on the fast break, and passing to her teammates ahead of her. She's really controlled the tempo of this game. She's a poised point guard. She's made a difference in this team. Last year, she had to sit out because she tore her ACL.
She has hit the only three-pointers for UConn. Penn State has actually done a better job from beyond the arc. The free throw line, a major difference there. Six out of six. Penn State has not shot a free throw. 37-28 as we start the second half. Great feed inside to Shepherd for the easy layup.
Well, they showed, you know, signs of brilliance like that every now and then, but I think Helen Darling not only has to pass the ball, but also has to score. She was 0 for 5 in the first half, and she's got to get some points on the board for this Penn State team.
Abrosimova left wide open, didn't want the shot. Now she'll take it from three. Rimmed out.
And I think that's the kind of shot that Penn State's got to give up. You want to stop Connecticut from getting the ball inside because those are easy shots, and Connecticut's going to score a higher percentage. Yes, Connecticut does have good outside shooters, but you know what? Start proving you got to beat us as long as you're guarding Sue Bird.
Walseth from 17. Got it. They need scoring from Walseth. She averages 14 points a game. That's only her second bucket of the night, but it cuts the lead to 5. Connecticut is led by as many as 12. Penn State never has led, and Swin Gag gets free inside. Her first pass. Excellent passing again. Wide open Garner for the bucket. She has 9.
First shot by Garner was right-handed. She's a left-handed.
Both teams able to find open players for easy buckets. There's another one inside. Schumacher scores. She had great position.
Really did a good job pinning Garner behind her off the rotation of the ball. They ball reversal, and Schumacher just cut right back to the strong side.
Good feeling there was a little chalk talk in both locker rooms at halftime. Garner misses the runner. Bird ahead to a Grossimova. Cash. Nice lean in. Offensive foul, Swin Cash. And Gino Auriemma rockets off the UConn bench.
Now those are the kind of defensive play the Lady Lions are going to have to do more of. Is it a flop? Hey, she banged her pretty good, so they got the call.
Once you lower the shoulder, you put yourself in jeopardy, and that'll be a foul on Sue Bird as she tries to come up to the double team. 1 on Sue Bird.
You know what the press does too, that Connecticut that being so aggressive, you might get some turnovers, you might get called for some fouls, but by the end of the game, how fresh is Penn State's legs going to be in the decision making?
Plus, it wears you out emotionally. Garner gets it into the corner. Shepherd for 3. And Penn State fired up here in the second half. Schumacher working hard to get 3 inside. Sue Bird, who had 3 threes in the first half, hits another one. She has killed Penn State from the outside. 14 on the night, 12 coming on 3-point shots.
Well, defensively, that's why it's so hard to focus on just one kid, because they have so many weapons. And yet Sue Bird's doing it in this game right now.
Boy, that's a nice job by Shepherd. She had a Brosimov on her shoulder and leaned in to get the foul. That is 2 on Svetlana.
Look at the penetration right there, ball movement. And wide open in the corner. The zone got stuck, not seeing where Shepherd is. Shepherd is the shooter for this Lady Lion team. Right now, Bird is the shooter for this Connecticut team. And you've got to spot up who they are and try and get somebody on them.
You had to wonder which Lisa Shepherd would show up tonight, the one that had 25 points in the Louisiana Tech win, or the one that had only 2 in the squeaker win they had over Iowa State. Nice catch by Schumacher. Brosimova had it knocked away. And they'll call a 3-second against UConn.
This UConn team with the seniors, Paige Sauer and Stacey Hansmeyer, they have not been to a Final Four. This is the only team since 96 that a Connecticut team hadn't been to a Final Four, and the seniors, they wanted to get there. And so it's a young team. A lot of people compared it to the 95 team when they won the national championship. And Gino Auriemma said, that team was an A+. This team's an A.
Well, I see similarities between them and Tennessee of 2 and 3 years ago, the team that won the national championship. And there are the stars from 95.
Carol Walters on the left of the screen, Jen Rosati in the middle, and Rebecca Lobo, who was player of the year in 95, who was on the Olympic team in 1996, and Carol Walters will represent the United States on the year 2000 team.
Last foul was on Falcone, her first. The lead is only 6 as we hit the 16-minute mark in this game. Step out double team. Bird, Schumacher can't handle a pass. Wall set. from behind by Schumacher, but a foul.
How do you like that? Maren Walter at 6'3". She's playing on the top of that zone with her size. It creates passing problems. Well, they came up with a steal, and she was out on the break. Had to catch up with her because Jay Ralph was right on her and made a nice pass to Garner.
Pretty good mobility. And Garner will go to the line. Young woman who had 12 double-doubles this year. An average a hefty 8.7 rebounds. She has 10 tonight. She has good bloodlines, too. Her cousin Charlie, a running back for the San Francisco 49ers.
Well, you look at the way she's built. I mean, she has 7 years of tap, ballet, and jazz dancing. Good balance.
Second free throw. Penn State giving UConn all it can handle. 44-40, back in a moment.
Watch NBA Tonight, Tuesday through Saturday on ESPN.
With two of the stars of that 1995 team that went undefeated 35-0, won the national title, Rebecca Lobo, Jen Rosati, thanks for getting up from your seat. Rebecca, as well as you know Gino, even though UConn's up right now, is he happy with the way his team's playing?
Well, to be honest with you, I think the only time I've ever seen him happy was after we won the whole thing back in 95 after that one game. So he has to feel pretty good, but I know he's been telling them in the huddle exactly what they need to do.
If they go on, Jen, to meet Tennessee, it'll be for the third time this season. They split in the regular season series. What needs to happen for them to beat Tennessee?
Well, I think that just losing to them in the regular season is incentive enough, but obviously they got to contain Tanika Catchings a little better than they did last time. But if they play good team ball, I don't think anybody can beat them.
All right, in a word, the 95 team versus this team right here, would you guys be able to beat them? Rebecca, you first.
My pride would have to say yeah, but I'll defer to Jen.
I plead the fifth. Good political answers, you guys. Thanks for joining us. Mike?
All right, thanks,
wow.
Michelle.
Hey, that's annoying. Yeah, you got to say yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, our team was better.
You'd have said that, wouldn't you?
I think so.
Tamika Williams will go to the line.
Williams in that first half was a big punch off the bench. The bench was really important for Connecticut in that first half. They scored 14 points and had 7 rebounds off the bench.
Sporting News National Freshman of the Year a season ago. Great bounce there.
You know, the one thing that Gino Auriemma talked about, that 95 team with Jen and Jamel, and, you know, they were tough kids, but they didn't have to play in a lot of tough games because they blew everybody out and going undefeated. Well, this team has had to play in a lot of tough games.
Garner hits the short jump shot to cut the lead back to 4, and Penn State hanging around, making it tough on Connecticut. Throws them over. Get it back outside. Kanuka Johnson. The foul is good. Asia Jones. You know, Auriemma can really get some great players off his bench. Rashauna Barnes had a big night off the bench for Penn State.
I think what Connecticut is doing, too, they're trying to keep the shots limited to Helen Garland. She's not getting the shots, even though she was missing in the first half.
For three, Sue Bird, another killer stroke. 51-44, and Sue Bird has 17 points. Boy, every time Penn State has made a run, Sue Bird has come through with a three, and what a pretty drive by Lisa Shepherd.
Lisa Shepherd has had a solid game so far for Penn State. They've got to turn it up a notch. They've got to do something on the defensive end to convert on the offensive end.
Excellent passing by UConn and the miss by Asia Jones as she got an excellent feed.
I mean, Penn State is really playing hard and they're playing tough, but you know they've got to do something that's really going to turn this game around for them.
Follow shot thrown away, and here comes Johnson on the run to a blows them over. She leans in, tried to create a foul. I thought that was a pretty good no call. Quickly back the other way, Shepherd. That would have been a big three. Offensive rebound to Darling. She can't hit it. Here comes the blows them over. One on two. She'll take it in anyway, and that's a block, and I thought that was a good call. You had Walseth moving ever so slightly, and if you lean, even after you plant your feet, They're not going to give you the call. That's three on her.
It was tough to get back on a break situation. I thought on the first time that Abramova had traveled, she makes the move there, and she's standing straight up. I think they could get, she could have gotten a charge call if she bends her knees. A lot of times, kids stand straight up off that charge.
Asia Jones off the inbound, and they made that look easy.
And those were a couple possessions that Penn State could have taken advantage of. They'd be right there.
Asia Jones has a dozen. The lead is back to seven. Penn State makes the run to get it close. Can't get over the top.
And the Lady Lions were doing a good job running. I think it kind of tired them out.
Shot clock is at eight. Shepherd a little bit out of control. Now she's diving and the ball is out of bounds to Connecticut.
The Penn State team is working so hard and they're not getting rewarded due to the Connecticut defense. But it's a great effort. You see the players going on the ground for it, and time is running out on the shot clock, and Walsett can't quite get to it.
And Connecticut looks very fresh.
Saw those fresh bodies off the bench. And Gino Auriemma compared this team to the Florida men. I mean, we've got 10 players. We can go with those players, and we're not going to get hurt.
No, you don't see much of a drop-off. Darling had to pick up her dribble, show her out all over a wall set. Nice move to force it up. The junior has 6 points and the lead back to five again.
Even if Connecticut doesn't score right away, they force Penn State to get back on the defensive end.
Williams can't hit the shot, but Asia Jones is there for the follow. Asia Jones with 14. .43 to go in the ballgame for the right to go to a national championship final against Tennessee on Sunday night. Garner passed on the easy shot, then takes a tough one and somehow slipped it right through.
Greeny Portland must have said something to Gray Garner in halftime as far as getting involved in this game.
Bird, nice job to get down the lane and hits the little runner. Sue Bird with 19. And if Connecticut wins this game, they can tip their hat to the offensive Sue Bird. She's been sensational. Garner cut off, goes to Walsett. Poor decision on her part. She says she was fouled.
Well, I thought she did a good job going underneath and trying to draw the foul.
10:59 to go in the game. The lead 7 for the Huskies.
What do I know about performance?
What do I know about control? What do I know about grip?
Great horsepower! Limited slip, rear differential. Full time, all-wheel drive. But what do we know?
We're just girls.
Subaru Forester. Sport utility tough, car easy.
In tennis, the advantage of the two-handed backhand is obviously power because you're using both hands. But it also is deceiving because in a split second, you can change the direction of the ball that you hit. Your opponent never knows if you're going to rifle it down the line or rip it cross court, and I like that.
Knowledge is the edge. At Invesco, it's the approach we use to make money for investors. Call your advisor or Invesco. You should know what Invesco knows.
To better nurture the rose, we had to get inside the mind of the rose.
I'm hot. I'm hungry. I'm just gonna wail. Oh, something's biting my leaf.
Introducing Bayer Advanced Garden 2-in-1 Rose and Flower Care. It works up through the roots, and it both feeds your roses and protects them from bugs in one easy step.
I will never go hungry again.
Or get nibbled.
Bayer Advanced. Better thinking, better results.
Hey, Mark, you order all this food?
Yeah, anywhere. And I don't have any. I'm cash poor.
Your dinner, you pay for it.
We're trying to get a little work done here.
Mark?
Can you add it on to whatever I'm paying you to live here?
Sort of like room service?
Yeah.
What's this look like? A Holiday Inn?
You want room service? You got it. Holiday Inn gives you more, and more is better.
Connecticut by 7 over Penn State. Be with us Monday. We'll bring you complete coverage of Major League Baseball's opening day at 1 o'clock on ESPN. The Milwaukee Brewers and the Cincinnati Reds. Followed at 4, the Chicago Cubs against my suddenly pitching rich St. Louis Cardinals over on the deuce at 2. At 1, the San Diego Padres against the Mets. At 4 on ESPN2, the Colorado Rockies and the Braves. Then at 10:30 on ESPN2, the world champion New York Yankees opening against the Anaheim Angels.
That was a great shot.
What an inbounds play.
Exactly. Coming out of a timeout, Penn State is one of the best teams on out-of-bounds plays and converting.
Walseth gets the bucket, and she'll have a chance to make it a three-point play. The foul was on Schumacher. That is her second. Walseth, the three-point play the old-fashioned way. It is a four-point ball game, and the number one team in the country cannot shake the Lady Lions.
Shea Ralph, who was the Big East Player of the Year, has been silent.
As if on cue, Shea Ralph buries the three. Boy, how many big threes have the UConn Huskies hit tonight, especially when Penn State makes that run? It's incredible.
Shea Ralph has struggled all game. She was 0 for 3 in the first half. This is the second shot, or I should say the first shot she's taken in this second half. She had plenty of time. You can see the defense by Penn State was collapsed. They could not get out on her at all.
SportsCenter will follow our telecast. The miss by Carr. Bird. Defense behind her, tries to shove it up with the right hand. Swing Cash had a hand on it. Sue Bird saved it. And now Sue Bird will reset it with 10-11 on the turning clock.
Sue Bird has been all over this court.
Is she fun to watch or what? She's such an intelligent player. Oh, what a great move and a great bounce pass in the bucket count. Swing Cash scores off a sweet assist.
One of the best passes we've seen, and all under control.
Well, she's given us her A game tonight in the national semifinal. 62-53. Barnes tries to power her way up. Bodies fly, no whistle, and Renee Portman is just outraged that there was no foul on that scene.
Well, you have to really appreciate that Penn State did go inside, and they're trying to get fouls.
Sue Bird with a runner. And more bodies on the floor.
Well, this game is really getting physical right now, especially after that last move. What a nice pivot move. The defense went with Sue Bird. The nice spin, that's what you call a pick and roll, and you just duck down underneath the defense. Swin Cash converting for the 2 points.
Just great awareness. Shea Ralph just picked up her third foul, and there you see the numbers on Sue Bird. 19 points, 5 assists. And beyond the raw numbers, it's when she has made the baskets and when she has gotten the assists for easy layup. They've all seemingly come a critical time.
And we've seen this team play in the East Regional Tournament, and they have lots of players on this team that are capable of doing that, not just Sue Bird.
Coming up when we're done here, they'll review all the day's action, including our games with the Major League Baseball and all the rest. 8:57. That one spins out, fights for the loose ball, and Tanisha Johnson comes out with it. A fresh 30 on the shot clock for UConn. Gino Auriemma up, calling out what he wants on offense. Another great feed. This will draw the foul. Swing Cash goes to the hoop. Just such tremendous control.
Connecticut's doing a good job. And again, Sue Bird, it's up to not only the person with the ball in their hands as far as coming off the screen has to stay set. But did you see how Swing Cash rolled off that and the defense went with her and she was able to get a clean catch on the ball?
Hits the free throw. Williams will come in, and Sue Bird will get a well-deserved rest.
Quinn Cash, the Pennsylvania Player of the Year.
Hits them both. The last foul on Nicole Anasinu into her team's lineup for the first time tonight. A blocking foul called. That'll be on Schumacher, her third.
Kent State has gotten so close, that, you know, it's almost like they don't know how much fuel is in the tank.
That's right. You expend all the energy to get back almost even. But you're not talking about playing against a team that doesn't know how to put the dagger between the ribs either. Free throw is good by Garner. She'll get another one. Garner and Darling, seniors on this ball club. Garner now has 17 points. 63-55. Now Penn State trying to press. To press UConn.
Well, I don't think anybody's been disappointed in these two games as far as how the point guards have played. All four teams have had their point guards come out to play.
Well, with UConn, you have so many other people that handle the ball so well and pass so well. Swin Cash will draw some contact inside. And that will be a foul on Walseth, and that is her fourth. They can ill afford to lose her down the stretch.
Swin Cash has the ability to put the ball on the floor from that high post position. She gets angles on people because of her quickness going up against the post players.
Only a 65% free throw shoot. There's Maren Walseth, and she will sit down at the 7:57 mark with that fourth personal. And they'll get Katrina Carr back in the ball game. Second free throw off target. And here comes Helen Darling trying to make something happen. Missed shot as Katrina Carr tried to go down the lane. A Brosa Mova, what a pass. Just a beautiful touch pass, and Cash finished it off.
And those are the kind of plays that Junior Auriemma talks about in the sense of his team making smart plays.
Garland cannot get by Kenitra Johnson. Shepard short on the effort, but the foul is good.
The one thing that Darling, I think, missing those five shots in the first half has frustrated her. And then defensively, Connecticut has taken the ball out of her hands as far as taking any kind of shot.
Cash kicks it back outside to Kenitra Johnson. Under 7 minutes to go, 9 on the shot clock. Abrosimova did a great job to get herself in position in the lane. Abrosimova now into double figures with 10. Penn State cannot trade baskets.
That's a big mismatch, too, with the Brooks moment at 6-2 with Darling on her 5-6.
Darling tries to get the dish inside for an easy bucket. Can't do it. Cash back the other way. Blows by the defender and score. She got Katrina Carr on her hip and took it to the hole. It's a 12-point lead. Connecticut still hustling, trying to make something happen on defense. Tamika Williams knocked that one out of bounds. Great passing by an unselfish group of players. The Connecticut Huskies, number one all year, lead Penn State by a dozen.
Actually, I couldn't think of a nicer person to spend the morning with. All right, sister, how about going around the table and then running a square in?
How about around the table, under the connect, and across the street?
Very, very gentle. Are you sure you want to do that? And most importantly, a very caring person.
I can catch it.
Said, hut! Be careful, sister!
Thank you.
You know about this? Did you catch that?
Coming back at you.
Looking for ways to improve your health?
Here's a simple exercise you can do right here or at home.
Want valuable tips to keep you safe? And advice on managing your estate?
I think most people should have a will.
If you're interested in trying new things, or just making the most of every day,
it's so wonderful.
Find the answers you need with a friend you can trust. Seeking Solutions with Suzanne. Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, exclusively on Comcast.
I want to give back to the community, and that's why.
Extended its lead to 12 over Penn State with 6:03 to go. The winner goes on to the national championship game Sunday night to meet Tennessee. The Lady Vols knocked out Rutgers earlier tonight in our first national semifinal game.
Carol Lawson, the freshman, took over in the second half as Kamika Catchings also came to play in the second half.
Back to live action, and Rashana Barnes knocks one down, her eighth point of the night.
Tennessee struggled in that first half against that Rutgers defense.
Williams low to Asia Jones, the pass a little strong and stolen by Shepard. Garland kicks it out to Falcone. Really missed the three badly.
I thought the pass was a little bit late.
Throws them over, gets it over. Now they'll work on the clock a little bit. Gina Auriemma says take it back outside. Throws them over, works around a screen down the lane. She loves that shot. Headed partially blocked, but the follow by Williams is good. Back to a dozen.
It's going to be hard for Penn State to get into that running game because we talked about their emotions and whether they're going to have their legs underneath them. The rebounding has been controlled by Connecticut, and they've been able to get fast breaks going.
They need some defensive stops as well. Kenny Mayne and Bill Pito coming up with SportsCenter. Reaction and analysis from here in Philly. The men's final four matchups and Shaq against Iverson. Two of the real stars in the NBA. Shea Ralph forces one up from the baseline, and she is fouled by Lisa Shepard.
It's almost like you, with Penn State, you kind of feel it going out of them. There's still plenty of time left to go, but they're going to have to get something going. Shea Ralph on the post-up right there, creating the contact, getting herself to the free throw line. She's always working hard.
A little bit of a break on that one. I think you're right. She created the contact, leaning in.
She does that a lot.
Yep. And more often than not, a player that does that will get the benefit of it. She can see well under her season's average. But the scoring load can carry by Sue Bird tonight. Biggest lead, 73-59. Penn State getting desperate for points as well as defensive stops on the other end. There is the steal. Kenitra Johnson, great anticipation, and then just flew down court. Now the margin is 16, and Rini Portland has seen enough of this run. She can see it slipping away here in the national semifinals. Just great anticipation, takes the steal, gets the bucket, and the nation's number one team with some breathing room. They're up 16 on Penn State.
When you have an ailment, different doctors might recommend...
It's like there is no clock or no lead. They're just going for the point.
They get the ball so deep in that lane, and what makes it so difficult to defend is they have such good outside shooters.
Poor pass that time by Garland. She tried to hit Shepard again. 3:17 to go. UConn opening it up.
He's too smart. I mean,
there's the pass to Leitner.
I love this part.
Puts it up. Yes!
I hate this movie.
Let's get out of here.
ESPN's exclusive coverage of the women's NCAA Final Four is brought to you by Nike.
Most of the night, Connecticut has been in a real battle with Penn State, but the battle is almost over with 3:17 to go. Second half field goal percentage, UConn shooting two-thirds and 6 out of 12 from three-point range. They finally got the fast break going. 14-4 fast break points for UConn. Abrosimova and Bird have been sensational for Gino Auriemma's club. Approaching the 3-minute mark. 18-point lead. Bird. A double team. Asia Jones with a jumper and a soft touch pays off again. Asia Jones with 16 points. And the lead is up to 20.
The Huskies have really done a good job, Mike, on that pick and roll, whether it be from the wing or at the high post position.
Nice reach in there and the steal by Kamiko Williams.
You don't see a lot of teams looking to hit the roll because off the double team, and sometimes the passer is not a good passer, but there are such good guards on the Connecticut team. They know where to get the roll.
Foul on Darling that time as Ralph tried to drive.
Their spacing has been really good as far as separating the defense, getting them wide,
right,
and getting, enabling themselves to get good passes in there.
Sports Center coming up when we're done here in Philadelphia, and Shea Ralph will take the line, hits the first. If you pick up the paper tomorrow morning and haven't seen much of this game, you might see a 20-point spread. It was not that wide open. Penn State gave UConn all it could handle for a long, long time. They just couldn't get over the hump. And now UConn just laying it on in the final stages. Nice speed. Shepherd can't get the bucket.
You know, I have to mention this. You talk about Reedy Portland and Gino Auriemma being from this area, and Vivian Stringer is, but, you know, Gino was talking about the Kathy Rush camp and the Immaculata College days, and he said, hey, we were all campers. We were all coaches at those camps. Get $100 a week, you know, and it was all about the Kathy Rush camp and how women's basketball, girls' basketball got started out here in Pennsylvania.
$100 a week and all the knowledge you could steal. Abrosimova foul on the baseline. It looks like Penn State's season is going to be over at 30-5. A tremendous campaign for them. 15-1 in the Big Ten. And Reedy Portland knows, barring a miracle of miracles, that the run has come to an end in her first Final Four.
And Gino Auriemma is sending his two seniors into the game. He's really been proud of the way that they accepted their roles. And, you know, they could have made it very tough on a lot of teams as players are delegated, especially as a senior, to the bench as a role player, not getting much playing time. But he has always given them confidence and thanked them for the role that they have played.
Absolutely. Abrosimova has a dozen. Stacy Hansmeier in the ballgame. She wears number 20. Paige Sauer, number 41.
And you have to wonder, going into the next game for Tennessee, who does Pat Summitt key their players on?
It's going to be a tough decision, isn't it? Nice job by Sauer to tip the loose ball to one of the teammates.
And both teams have players that can step up. Can't just key in on one.
And they have played twice this year, each one on the other's home court. Excellent pick and roll. The shot won't go for Hansmeier. Abrosimova tonight, 12 points, 10 rebounds, 4 assists. Just a tremendous performance by her. During the regular season, here's what we were talking about. Sue Bird had 25 points, hit 8 out of 10 field goals as UConn won at Tennessee, 74-67. She was absolutely brilliant. Christy Falcone with a miss. Anajanu with a rebound. And Anajanu gets her name in the scorebook. But it's 22 points, and the only thing that will be decided from here on out will be the final margin. And looking ahead, I know you saw both of the ball games, as did I during the regular season. Who on a neutral court, who do you think would be favored tomorrow? Or Sunday?
It's going to be tough. I still think you've got to go with Connecticut in the sense that they are the number one team coming in. 2 years ago, Tennessee, the defending national champion from 2 years ago. The last time those two teams met in a Final Four, 4 years ago in 96, semifinal game went into overtime. It was one of the most exciting games, and Tennessee came out ahead and one of the six national championships that Pat Summitt and the Tennessee team won. So, I mean, it's a game, it's a rubber match game. Obviously, it can go either way because both those games this year were very good.
Ralph getting a little bit of a rest. And there's a Brosimova who will sit down with 14 points, 10 rebounds, 4 assists, another sterling floor game. And Sue Bird had 19 points, 5 assists, not a single turnover in the ball game for Sue Bird, even though she handled it against a lot of pressure. Just a tremendous performance. Ashley Luke trying to get a bucket. And they get it off instead to Katrina Carr, and she hits one. Kenequa Jackson will bring it up to Paige Sauer.
Just looking to run it down.
About a 12-second difference between the game clock and the shot clock. And Johnson fouled by Ashley Luke, the freshman from Aurora, Illinois. And our Nike player of the game, Sue Bird, who hit 5 of 7 three-point shots at critical junctures in this ball game, finished with a total of 19 points and had no turnovers. Just a brilliant effort. And in that first game that Connecticut beat Tennessee, she was certainly the difference when they played Knoxville.
It's so tough to guard her because she gets rid of the basketball so quickly. And it'll be interesting to see what kind of pressure she gets from Tennessee as far as handling the basketball. As you said, no turnovers. I mean, that's fabulous in this kind of pressure game.
Well, it's fabulous if you're playing in your driveway. It's tremendous in this game. Connecticut wins its 35th game of the season, 35-1, with one to play in the 2000 season. Tennessee eliminates Rutgers in the first game. Connecticut has just knocked off Penn State. Tennessee and Connecticut, the much-anticipated final for the championship right here on ESPN, Sunday night at 8:30 Eastern. We hope you will join us for that. Once again, the final score, UConn 89, Penn State 67. For Ann Myers and Michelle Tafoya and our entire ESPN crew, this is Mike Patrick. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com. Part of the Go Network, go.com.
Now on this sports...
Like that. This is the kind of scene it is here in Philly. You know, the Connecticut-Tennessee rivalry is intense is a very intense rivalry. The players may change. The intensity does not. But Vera, who really needs to step up in this game?
Well, there's a couple of people that come to mind immediately. Kara Lawson, first and foremost, from Tennessee. What a dominant point guard she has emerged to become. She's very, very confident on the stroke from the three-point line, and that makes her a great distraction to get some inside game. And she knows when to park it and when to put it in drive. Averaging only one turnover a game, which is a phenomenal statistic. And I think even when you look at all her numbers, the fact that she's so young and that she's averaging only one turnover a game makes her fantastic. Svetlana Abrosimova, however, comes to mind to me when we talk about great offensive weapons. Off the drive, she can do it. Off the dribble, penetration. And she's probably best known for her rebounding and her ability to go coast to coast. Unstoppable. The other fascinating statistic, however, is that she is the leader in all categories offensively in points, rebounds, and assists. Now, there have been some comments on who's the best player on the team and who isn't. I can tell you she is definitely the best offensive weapon. In fact, she reminds me of myself in my playing days.
Wow, that's quite a compliment to her. Well, I can tell you who the best player in America is. It's Tamika Catchings of Tennessee, and it's because she has such a multifaceted game on both ends of the floor. If you put too much defensive attention on Catchings, she will find open teammates and deliver the ball. She's a very good passer and an unusually good defender. She's got great feet, active hands, and she is a blue-collar hard worker, but she's also a versatile scorer. Catchings really brings the magic for Tennessee, and you can tell from her numbers, she is outstanding. Whenever there is a magic, though, in a game like this, there is bound to be a bird, and for UConn, that is Sue Bird, and she is the best all-around point guard in America. She is great off the dribble. She can penetrate and deal and make the delivery. Averages almost 5 assists per game, and she is a dynamite shooter. She hits 51% from the field and 51% from three-point range. She is a great point guard with the ability to control the game.
And another player that I'm keeping an eye on is Tamika Randall. She always plays so well against Tennessee, averaging over 21 a game in her career against Connecticut. Well, you know, it's a big game with the car. You know, thanks for loaning him his car, so he can get to the First Union Center. Yes, the cause is here. He'll join us on our preview show at 8:30 Eastern, so you join us as well.
There, Robin. We will return to the ice in a moment. The Devils' lead in the East is shrinking. Just 2 points with 4 games to go. We'll check to see if they are creating some elbow.
Love banging.
And we're going to fight as hard as we can to try to bring the championship home.
I love to beat them by 30.
And we expect them to do the same.
The rivalry was fueled by 2 classics this season, both times a visiting team winning on the other's floor. Tonight, yet another chapter, this time for the national championship.
Well, when the school is down and the shift that was done, the girls together, I get a ball in a run. I'm a lace on my sleeve, I kick off them shoes. I'm gonna play to win, cause you know I don't like to lose. And take a part, you got the best competition. Good move, baby. I'm at definition, they shoot at who? Yeah, they play it basketball, shoot 'em out.
William Penn's perpetual eastern stare may shift due south down Broad Street. We welcome you to Philadelphia and the final game of Final Four Weekend. ESPN's Championship Sunday is underway and the participants are here as well. Tonight, the underdog, 6-time national champions, an injury earlier today to ace Clement may hinder hopes of winning a 7th national title for Tennessee. As for UConn, number one since day one, the Huskies are as impressive as their 35-1 record would indicate. Only 20,060 are going to get in here inside the First Union Center, and tickets are a hot item. And we welcome you inside the First Union Center. And boy, oh, look, what a way to watch the game. If you don't have a ticket, folks, don't worry. I assure you, you have the best seat on the house here on ESPN. And this is what they're playing for. Who will hold that over their heads at the end of the night? Tennessee or Connecticut? Hello again, everyone. Alongside Jay Billis and Vera Jones, I'm Robin Roberts, and we are ready for some basketball. But is Tennessee going to be ready without ace Clement, who was injured today in practice? It happened about noontime today here in Philadelphia in practice on this very floor. Ace Clement came down on Michelle Snow's foot, rolled her ankle. It's been determined as a sprain, and her status for this game is uncertain, and they'll determine it at game time. And she was so critical in the game on Friday as she is coming back home. This is where she played her high school ball. She was looking forward to playing in front of a lot of family and friends. She had 8 of Tennessee's first 10 points, including 2 3-pointers. And the intangibles that you brought, as you can see the excitement in her face. And what does this mean right now for Tennessee?
Well, first of all, it's a distraction to see her coming in on crutches, and it can really kind of throw Tennessee off a little bit. But mostly it's a question of lineup flexibility for Pat Summitt. She has point guard skills, does Ace Clement. She's able to handle the ball against pressure. She's also a very good shooter, and it also affects defensive matchups because Clement was going to spend a great deal of time guarding Sue Bird. If she is unable to play, that's going to be significant.
Well, I can tell you what it's going to mean to Connecticut. While we are very, very sympathetic, and I'm sure all the fans will be if she does not play, Gino Auriemma is a warrior and a competitor. He's going to get right on it. It means more pressure defense. It also means they will be able to sag off a little bit and play the inside because they won't have to be so concerned about the outside or the perimeter game as much. He'll probably save his sympathies till after the game.
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, any true champion, as both of these two teams are, they want both to be at full strength. But that may not be the case, and we'll know at game time shortly. All right. They have met 10 previous times. It has been a war each and every time they have gone out on the floor. 10 meetings, each winning 5 times. It's the 4th time that it's number 1 versus number 2, and the 2nd time they will play for a national championship. And look at that total score. Only 4 points. In favor, 3 points, I'm a little shaky in my math, 3 points in favor of the UConn Huskies. As we said, this is the 3rd meeting this season. Now let's take a look back at the previous 2 meetings of this season. Bird's 25 points helped Connecticut to the 63-52 second half lead. The Lady Vols fought back, though. Kyra Elzey's lay-in cut the double-digit lead to 3. But moments later, in a position to cut the 3-point lead to 1, Michelle Snow draws a 5th foul on Paige Sauer. A positive reaction draws a negative response. Snow is given a technical foul, and Lady Vols come back lost steam. Connecticut carried the momentum swing to a 74-67 win in game number 1. Game 2 featured a revenge-minded Tennessee trying to return the favor. Samika Randall's jumper put the balls up 70-69, only to be answered by Sue Bird. The driving layup put the Huskies up by 1, but back comes Randall. Always comes up big against the Connecticut Huskies. Tough jumper in traffic. Tennessee back up 72-71. A last chance at maintaining perfection. Comes up short at the buzzer by Tamika Williams. And they split the first 2 games. And it's amazing that each time they were all both saying, we're number 1, we're number 1, where they're going to be able to prove who's number 1 tonight, Jay.
And this is so emotionally charged. Each team really wants to beat the other because these are the 2 best teams in all of college basketball. Tennessee has been the gold standard in women's college basketball. They've been the top dog for so long, you can't even remember when they weren't. And UConn is now a legitimate threat to that. And all you need to know about how much Tennessee wants to beat UConn, before this tournament started, all the Tennessee players were asked, what's the best moment you've had this season? And almost without exception, they said, beating UConn at Stores. Hello, Tennessee won the Southeastern Conference Championship, and they beat the USA national team, but all they want to do is beat UConn. I think it's just winning the national championship is just a byproduct of beating UConn.
Absolutely.
Well, I think UConn definitely, it definitely deserves its props now, but the way I see it, Tennessee has held this rivalry 6 national championships. UConn did not become good until they beat Tennessee. So how big is this? You figure it out.
It's like Chrissy Martina, Ali Frazier, as Pat Summitt said, you have to play the best to be the best. We have more here on the NCAA Women's Championship special. Coming up, we'll break down the key matchups, including the pressure on the point guards, freshman Kara Lawson and sophomore Sue Bird of Connecticut. And in the front court, the primary focus, a pair of regional MVPs, All-Americans Tamika Catchings and UConn's Svetlana Abrosimova. And also coming up a little later on, a look at the rivalry through the eyes of the participants, both past and present. Much more to come here from Philly, so come on back.
Story about the playgrounds in Philly. This is a story about believing that hard work pays off in the end. This is a story that begins right here on this court. Every day going one-on-one with the guys, Believing. Believing that you can win. Believing in yourself. Believing in your dreams. Who says women have no game? This is a story about the playground on the streets in Philly. And this is the payoff. The hard work. The sweat. This is why it's all worth it. Believe and make it here.
There is something special about Philadelphia, and the fans are here for Tennessee and for Connecticut. Don't worry, folks. They are both well represented, and they cannot wait for tip. T-minus 22 minutes and 15 seconds. Don't worry. You're not going to miss anything. Let's get to the X's and O's about the matchups. Point guard position always so key in this matchup. Now, these two point guards most likely will not guard each other, but still a very important matchup.
Tara Lawson is the one that's going to be all eyes on her for Tennessee. She is a dominating point guard, just a freshman. She said, I'm tired of all the talk about the freshman. Look what I can do. I can pop it from three, and she does it with such confidence. That opens up the middle very nicely. Got a player to penetrate. She can take the drive as well. She knows when to park it and when to drive. And I'm telling you, she's averaging only one turnover a game. Of all the stats that I see, that's the one, as far as I'm concerned, that's most impressive.
Well, Kara Lawson is outstanding, but I think that Sue Bird is the best point guard in this tournament. She is great off the dribble, an outstanding shooter and scorer, and a fantastic passer. When she puts the ball on the floor, she makes great decisions. She finds open people and delivers the ball on the money. She also shoots over 50% from three. When she can pull up and hit her jump shot, she is very dangerous. A point guard's job is to get the ball to the best option. Oftentimes, she is the best option. I think she needs to call her number more often tonight.
And ironically, both had 19 points and no turnovers in the respective semifinal games on Friday. But the MVPs, the ones they really go to, Tamika Catchings for Tennessee.
Well, Tamika Catchings is the best player in the country because she has the most multifaceted game on both ends of the floor. She not only can score, she is an outstanding defender, and she's a very good passer. If you go to double team, she can dump it off to open people. It's going to be a very difficult defensive assignment for anybody trying to guard her.
As for Connecticut, there's lots of talk about who's the best defense or the best weapon, and right now Svetlana Abrosimova definitely has to be that person. Offensively, if nothing else, she leads in all three major offensive categories: points, rebounds, and assists. She is the best offensive rebounder I've seen in a long time, and they have to make sure they shut her down.
And she has to make sure that she steps up a little bit more than she did on Friday. Yeah, she had a double-double, but when you're as good as Svet, you got to bring a little bit more to the table. But she was the East Regional MVP. You see her numbers in this NCAA tournament, and that is the go-to player for the Lady Vols, Tamika Catchings. Back with more in a moment.
We can see all our production schedules on one calendar.
We can share a document internally and with the client.
Now groups can compare schedules.
Post documents.
Collaborate.
Communicate.
Anytime, anywhere.
Through your own private space on the web.
Your intranets.com site.
It's easy.
It's free.
Go to intranets.com.
And set up your secure site.
Intranets.com.
Get everyone on the same page.
For free. Forever.
Beauty. Adventure. Drama. All these and more can be yours in the wonderful world of art. And with this free art test from Art Instruction Schools, you can find out if you have the interest and desire needed to become a serious art student. To get your free art test without cost or obligation, call this toll-free number. Don't delay. Call this toll-free number now.
Call 1-800-633-3400.
Major League Baseball's opening day in the U.S. Start your day at noon on ESPN2 with the premiere of Baseball Today. Then join John Miller, Joe Morgan at 1 p.m. Eastern on ESPN, the Brewers and Reds. That's right, Ken Griffey Jr.'s debut. And at 1 p.m. on ESPN2 with the Pods and the Mets. Followed at 4 p.m. on ESPN with the Cubs and Cards. And over on ESPN2 at 4 p.m., Rockies and Braves. Finally at 10:30 Eastern on ESPN2, World Champion Yankees and the Anaheim Angels. And Tennessee is out on the floor here. here at the First Union Center. And Rocky Top, let's start counting. That's the first time we've heard it. It will not be the last time that we hear it tonight. And also coming up in just about under 20 minutes, Boys to Men, Philadelphia's own Boys to Men, I know you're swooning over there, Vera, will perform the national anthem. Despite only 10 previous meetings, it's an intense rivalry, as you know, between Connecticut and Tennessee. It's based on a mutual respect for one another, but that disappears as soon as they hit the court.
Definitely a respect factor off the court. On the court, you have no respect for anybody. It's just bitter, it's angry, it's, you know, you're just competitive. And not even, it's like fierce competitiveness.
And every time we play them, everybody's going all out. It's basically a battle. I mean, it's really aggressive, a lot of banging, a lot of pushing in there.
We know that they want to come out there and just kill us and kick our butts, but we know that they know we want to do the same, and I think that's what makes the rivalry so fun.
I mean, this has happened in a short period of time, and it's happened quickly. And the intensity level, and it's a flame that burns, like, really bright and intense.
I don't get emotional, you know. I either get mad or happy. Mad when I think about losing, and happy when I think about the win.
That's it. The Lady Vols have won a title game.
Beating them for the national championship, going 35-0, that was one of the greatest Tennessee-Connecticut moments in my mind.
We ended up losing that game in 95. That was a key moment for me. I've replayed that several times in my head ever since it's happened. And then in 96, when we were playing UConn in the semifinal, I was so excited and I was so focused going into that game that there wasn't anything that could possibly get in the way of Tennessee.
Losing to them to end my career will always stick in my mind.
During Kara's senior year in 97, they had like 34-0. We're down in Iowa City, the final in the regional. We kind of knocked them off to advance to the Final Four.
And the dream has ended for Connecticut.
Seems like something's always on the line when we come to meet, whether it's a national championship, a Final Four, or a number one ranking.
Not only are we playing this game to win the national championship, but we're kind of defending our honor.
If you look at it from a selfish standpoint, I want to play the best. I think that's how you become the best.
Everyone who aspires to be really, really good at what they do needs someone to push the envelope and raise the bar a little bit. I think we do that for them, and I think they do it for us.
It's great to have two competitive teams that want to win so bad playing for the ultimate prize.
The tradition behind both programs is tremendous, and I know we're going to be, you know, playing for a little bit more out there.
You know, it's hard to believe that this series only dates back to 1995. The intensity stays the same. The changes involves the players. We have two very interested spectators. The first is with our Michelle Tafoya.
All right, Robin, thanks very much. It is amazing that this rivalry has grown exponentially over the course of 5 years. It really did start with that game that you guys won that put you into the number one spot in the polls for the first time ever. With the benefit of all that hindsight, how do you look back at that game and what it meant to this rivalry?
It meant a lot to women's basketball. It meant so much to the Connecticut program because Tennessee was already established as a national powerhouse, and that's what put UConn up in the same kind of category with Tennessee.
So I know you like to be diplomatic about these things, but if you can get down to the core of this rivalry, is it hatred? Is it pride? Is it you've got something we want? What is it all about?
It's about mutual respect. You always want to get it from the best team, and these are the two best programs. You respect each other so much that you want to be on the top and have those bragging rights.
You get to see another one tonight. Let's send it over to Pam Ward, who is with Shamequa Holtzclaw.
All right, thank you, Michelle. And yes, Shamequa Holtzclaw decked out in her Michelle Snow jersey, ready to go for Tennessee. Let's talk about the rivalry a little bit. You played in six of these games. Yes. Tennessee won four of them. Was this the biggest game of the year for you guys?
I mean, this is big. You know, UConn-Tennessee, it doesn't get any better. And it's exciting that the fans, you know, and all these people here get to see two great teams compete.
Have you seen the rivalry change? You came in the first year right after UConn had the unbeaten season and beat Tennessee in the final.
Yeah, that was kind of like the beginning stages. Now it's on a whole new level, you know. It's really intense, and I think this is something the game needs right now.
And when you played, was obviously in the SEC, you played Georgia and great teams like that just about every day. Was this the game that you kind of circled on your calendar as a team?
It's two games you circle, Connecticut and Louisiana Tech, the biggest games of the year. And this is what we live and die for, these type of games right here.
And who wins tonight?
Oh, Tennessee.
All right, Shamequa, thanks a lot. Robin, back to you.
All right.
Pam, what do you think she's going to say? Oh, yeah, Connecticut is going to win. But you were involved in an intense rivalry, Duke, North Carolina. What is that like, Jay?
Well, it's a lot of emotion. And when you add the national championship into the picture, it's even more emotion. And how these teams channel that emotion tonight, I think, could be a significant factor, because emotion can jack you up, but it can also wear you down if you're a little bit too high.
That's definitely very important. Emotion is going to definitely factor into this. But my main point right now is the rivalry is great. I got a great one with my husband. We play Scrabble. I'm winning. But the bottom line is you have to go into this contest thinking we're playing to win a national title, not thinking I don't want to lose to those guys. Not a good idea. So as long as they can focus on winning, that's all that matters.
But something else they have to focus on, we've just gotten word that Ace Clement will not start. Kyra Elzy will start in her place. She sprained her ankle in practice today. But another Philadelphia native will be joining us soon, the Cuz, Bill Cuz. And he comes bearing gifts. Yeah. We'll have more of the NCAA preview show in just a moment. So come on back. What do you got in there? Trying to win his second national title. Emotions on his sleeve at all times. Tonight he hopes the passion will pay off. And Putt Summit, unmatched success, another opportunity to add to a collection of national championships. Is it just a coincidence or maybe not? Two famous steakhouses here in Philadelphia. One has a name of Gino, the other the name of Pat. And which one is best? Well, it all depends on the patrons that you ask.
The rivalry, you know, one side versus the other.
We like Pat!
Gino's and Pat go head-to-head. Gino's will win.
What was the other name of the other place?
Gino's and Pat's are very similar, but they're different.
The flavor is more intense than Pat's sticks.
Gino's will give you a service with a smile. Pat's is all serious about it.
The cheese steak.
Cheese steaks are tougher at Pat's. I like them better at Gino's.
The more spicier at Pat's than Gino's.
Hotter at Gino's.
Service with a smile all the time, 24/7.
My dad works at Gino's, and I guess I still love him.
Oh, good eating, man.
Oh.
And joining us, Philadelphia's own, who's so disturbed by Temple Men, but we won't get there, Bill Cosby.
Well, the Temple Men are disturbed, so it's all over now.
It's over.
What do you mean
it's over? We got a game going on.
That's why I'm here. I'm here to see some great basketball. And they woke me up. I was sleeping in my house. I heard all this noise. Followed it all the way down Broad Street. You know who it was?
Who was it?
The three of you.
Oh, was it?
Running your mouths, going in and out of wild steakhouses.
Well, you know, I think you're showing favoritism because you have a Gino's steak bag, not a Pat's steak bag. Why Gino's? Do you?
Well, today is Sunday.
Right.
That's Gino Day. Monday, I'll be at Pat's.
Oh, you're good.
Yes, I have to go back and forth.
Well, and you're running for office with those kind of answers?
No, just freebies. Uh-huh. Freebies. How come you have on sneakers and nobody else does?
Oh, come on now. Don't bust
me. Oh, you're going to bust me. I'll bust you. She's got on sneakers like somebody's going to call you to run out there. I don't think, not at this speed.
Well, what would happen if they called you to run out there? You think you could hang with any of these women?
Not for one second, Doctor. I don't even want to be next to them when they're jumping up and down. Now, this is the most wonderful thing I've ever seen. A man with four daughters, I am, and I've got to tell you, the spirit from Althea Gibson to Jackie Joyner Kersee out here, and these parents, all of this, and it's college, and they graduate.
Oh, that's
and they're
indeed
serious.
That's right.
And I love all of this, man. And this is basketball. This is not three dribbles and stop. three women on one side, three on the other. And they were afraid that certain things would fall out and they would be ruined for life. No, this is sure enough. This is basketball. And this is I can beat my father basketball. Yes, it is. That's what it is.
Do you have a favorite personal basketball moment?
Yes, I have many, but most of them just have to do with I stayed in the game.
That was a moment.
I was sent in to foul people. That's all.
You won't let the enforcer. Mr. C, thank you so much.
Thank you
You're
for having me.
You're a gracious host. We appreciate it. Hang around, I know. We have the tip between Connecticut and Tennessee in less than 6 minutes. Boys to Men will perform the national anthem when we come back.
That's right.
Do you have whooping in a can?
No, we only have it in jail form, and it's on aisle four.
Now, this maple has a bounce ratio of 8.3.
How do I raise my roof?
And Netmaster 2000 works on any net.
Next. Both hands up, keep your elbows straight, and use this motion here.
Thank you very much. I will do that.
Well, it's going to come down to offensive rebounds and free throws. UConn has got to keep Tennessee off of the offensive glass. They've got to play good defense without fouling and not put Tennessee on the free throw line. Make Tennessee make challenge shots.
And everything has changed because Ace Clement is not expected to play. That means more defensive pressure, and somebody's got to stop Sue Bird.
It has the feel of a heavyweight fight here in Philadelphia. Sit back, enjoy, everyone. We'll see you at halftime. The tip between Connecticut and Tennessee is coming up. Boys to Men will sing the national anthem. What more can we say? It does not get any better than this. The Philly final, Connecticut and Tennessee, number one versus number two.
We can see all our production schedules on one calendar.
Presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports.
Young women between the legs, around the back. This is not your grandmother's basketball. We're looking at college basketball at its finest. Philadelphia is a champion. Between two teams, somebody's going to wind up being a champion.
Meeting one, Sue Bird is the star. UConn wins at Tennessee. Meeting two, the All-Americans Catchings and Randall return the favor. Meeting three, the national championship. From the First Union Center in Philadelphia, this is the national championship game between the 33-3 Lady Vols of Tennessee and the 35-1 Connecticut Huskies. Good evening, everybody. I'm Mike Patrick along with Ann Myers. It's great to have you with us. For the first time since 1995, number one will meet number two for the national title. They've already played twice this year. They split, and one of those games was Connecticut's only loss of the year.
And this is a rubber match game. As a matter of fact, Connecticut's been playing much better since that loss. Gino Arroyo says Sue Bird, the sophomore, is the MVP of this team. She's like a bullet train. She's fast, smooth, and sleek, shooting over 50% from three-point range. 5 of 7 against Penn State from three-point range in that big win. Does she have one more game in her? And she can pass it to her teammates, and that's really important.
Tennessee got some really bad news this morning. Near the end of their shoot-around, their starting guard, Kristen Ace Clement from Philadelphia, injured her ankle.
That really is a tough break for Tennessee. Clement, a real smart player, a tough player, but they're going to start Kyra Elzy in that defensive position. This team, though, Tennessee has been led by a freshman. Ever since that win against Connecticut, Kara Lawson has taken them to 20-plus wins.
Let's get the starting lineups for both ball clubs. The Pert Plus starting lineup.